No? You don't want Baptist? You want me to change church? Who are you looking at? Tracy, do you want to move over? Let's go ahead and do that. Let's go ahead and do that before I start the service. Hey, Tim. Has everybody found the seats that they want to be in the rest of the service? Because he's got a long sermon prepared for tonight. In our Baptist hymnals, if we'll turn to page 335. Start thinking, by the way.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in my eyes, I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises of God my Savior, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises that cannot fail.
Anybody? What was that? 260? 260. I don't know that one. Oh, yeah, I have. I knew that. 260. Good. I had to take a minute there.
Brethren, we have met to worship and adore the Lord our God. Will you pray with all your power while we try to preach the Spirit of the Holy
you don't get to ask. Anybody else? Yeah, I don't know that.
I'll leave it. No. Leave it. I mean, you're the ones knows it.
Turn with me in Genesis chapter 29. We're going to look in chapters 29 and 30. And we're looking at the lives of Rachel and Leah. But it's not just Rachel and Leah. It is a pattern that you see throughout this Genesis story. Frankly, it's a pattern that you and I have seen in people's lives around us. Hopefully not in your family, but maybe. And so I want to look here tonight at what God's Word has to say about Rachel and Leah. And hopefully we can learn something about God, something about others, something about ourselves, and along the way maybe some mistakes to avoid as we go through life. So Genesis chapter 29, beginning in verse 31, and listen to what God's Word has to say. When the Lord saw that Leah was hated, He opened her womb, but Rachel was barren. Would you all pray with me? Heavenly Father, we thank You for this day. We thank You for the blessings of it. We thank You for watching over us the way You have. Lord, we thank You for this evening and the chance to gather, to praise Your name, to study Your Word. Father, help us tonight to listen, to learn, to grow, to be more like Jesus and less like the old person we used to be. And if somebody here is lost, I pray that tonight would be the night they come to know You as Lord and Savior. Thank You for all the things You've done for us and all the things You're going to do for us. But above all things, thank You for Jesus Christ. And it's in His name we pray. Amen. My Bible's sticking together there. My wife has a dog. And y'all, it's Maverick is his name. Just like Top Gun. Except not as awesome. He's a... He's a miniature long-haired Dachshund. And so just to give you some background on this story, when I was a kid, I loved dogs. I did when I was a kid, always have. Except the only dog I really didn't like was my cousin Melissa's dog, which was a full-sized Dachshund. It's the only dog that ever bit me. Right on the nose. I reached down to pet it, and that dog jumped up and bit me on the nose. And I never did like that dog. And now we own a small version of that dog. And I tell you all that to say this. It might surprise you to find this out. I think if my wife had to choose between me or the dog, I am not sure that I might not lose out. Well, okay, yeah, she shrugged her shoulders. She really didn't dispute that. I think she might like the dog better than me. That's the point I'm trying to get at here. And in fairness, the dog loves Krista. Sits on her lap constantly. It follows her around. If she sits down, he jumps up on her lap. He rides in the car with her. If she'll let him, sits on her lap in the car. The dog loves Krista. He bites me a lot. Me and Dachshunds have a long history of being bitten now. And so he bites me a lot. He loves Krista. And I tell you that to say this. This story is one among several in Genesis of favorites. And I don't know which is Krista's favorite, me or the dog, but I might lose out on that one. Now, I'd say this. Some families do that. Y'all ever seen families where one of the family members, one of the kids maybe is a favorite? Like, for instance, in our family, I'm the favorite son out of me and my two brothers. I'm the favorite, clearly. Well, some families do that today. They did it in the Bible. And so we see that today. If you remember where we're at now, so let me catch you up. Genesis is the book of beginnings. It tells a lot of different beginnings. It tells about the beginning of creation and the beginning of time. It tells about the beginning of man. Adam and Eve were created. It tells about the beginning of sin in Genesis chapter 3. And we read how sin entered the world. And then after that we read about the beginning of God's work. And here's the Bible. You ready? You want to understand the Bible? The Bible is God revealing Himself to man and reconciling man to Himself. That sums up the Bible. And that Genesis tells us the beginning of that. So God is revealing. And so you ever wondered why Jesus didn't just come on the scene and that's it? Well, there's a reason. God had to reveal Himself to man. Sin entered the world and we don't know God anymore. Not like we should, not like we could. Sin has separated us from God. And God had to work to reconcile man to Himself. And so part of that process was God revealing Himself to man again. He used to walk with them in the cool of the evening, and then Adam and Eve are hiding from God because they're naked. That's what happened. We separated ourselves from God because of sin. And now God is revealing Himself to man and redeeming man to Himself, and all of that ultimately pointing us to Jesus. But before we can get to Jesus, a lot of other things have to take place. One of the things that has to take place is the beginning of the patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And out of the patriarchs comes the nation of Israel. That's the 12 tribes of Israel, the 12 sons of Jacob. That's going into slavery in Egypt, being delivered miraculously by the power of God, being given the Ten Commandments after they're delivered. All of that sort of has to take place. But we have to get there first. We're leading up to that, but we're not there yet. And so we're looking at the lives of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob currently. We've made it down to Jacob. And what we find is that Jacob, if you are looking at the beginning of grace, and that's what this is telling us about grace and faith. Jacob doesn't deserve grace. But neither do you. Neither do I. Well, Jacob is a perfect poster child for us. Perfect poster child. He was the perfect picture of a sinful man who does not deserve the blessings of God and gets it anyway. And so Jacob is now going to find a wife, and he wants to marry Rachel. He loves her. She's beautiful. Wants to marry her, but his uncle Laban says, no, that's not how it works. You got to marry the older sister before you can marry the younger. So the Bible says that she had weak eyes. And I think a rough translation of that is this. She wasn't much to look at. I think that's how you understand weak eyes. She wasn't much to look at, especially in that verse. It says, she had weak eyes, but Rachel was beautiful and attractive. So it seems to be contrasting those two. She wasn't much to look at. Rachel was beautiful. She's the older sister. You're not supposed to say stuff like this. This is chauvinistic. And boy, especially today, Leah was the older sister and she was the uglier sister. I don't know a nice way of saying that. There's not a nice way to say it. She just seems to, she was not as pretty, I guess. And Jacob wants to marry Rachel. Laban sort of tricks him into marrying Leah. And I know you want to know how you can trick somebody into marrying the wrong woman. Well, you can. It happened. And there's ways. Marriage was a little different in those days. They didn't have the big ceremony and the bride comes down and everybody looks at her and gawks at her and takes pictures of her. It was a little different then. And so he tricked her into marriage. He tricked Jacob into marrying Leah. And then he says, if you work for me 7 more years, you can marry Rachel. So he worked for 7 years, married the wrong woman, and then worked 7 more years and married the other sister, married to both sisters, Leah and Rachel. And then we start where we began tonight, verse 31. And when the Lord saw that Leah was hated, he opened her womb, but Rachel was barren. So here is a good character study in favoritism and bitterness. Jealousy and favoritism. And that's what we're looking at here. So here's the first thing you see. First lesson we can learn from the story of Leah and Rachel, and that's this. Just because you are favored by man does not mean you're favored by God. And just because you're favored by God does not mean you're going to be favored by man. Those are not always the same. We look at the outside, and we can try to determine who we think is favored by God. And more importantly, we often look at people and try to decide who we think is under the judgment of God. Now, it happens in the Old Testament, it happens in the New Testament. You know, Jesus healed a man born blind, John chapter 9. And this man's born blind, the disciples say, why was this man born blind? Was it for his sins or for his parents' sins? Now, they didn't ask, was it for sin? They just wanted to know which one. Was it his sins or his parents' sins? Because they assumed this was the judgment of God and it had to be for one of the sins, either his or his parents. One of those people, either him or his parents, one of them is a sinner and a way worse sinner than the rest of us because we're not blind. They looked at the outside and they determined who they thought God favored and who He didn't. Jesus' disciples did it in John, and people do it reading the Genesis story. Samuel goes to anoint a king over Israel. God has rejected Saul. And God sends Samuel to the house of Jesse to anoint one of his sons, the new king over Israel. And one by one, from the oldest to the youngest, he looks at Jesse's sons. And the Bible records that each one was more favorable than the next. Every time a new son came along, the next youngest son, Samuel would look at the man and say, that's the guy, that's the guy. Oh, look at that. Oh, he's strong and impressive and handsome. And that's got to be the one that God wants to be king. Every time that young man would come forward, God's Holy Spirit would speak to Samuel and say, that's not the one. He finally asked Jesse, don't you have any more sons? Jesse said, well, yeah. I've got one more son, just a young teenage boy. He's not old enough to be king. He's just a shepherd boy out in the field tending sheep. He's not a man yet. Samuel said, well, bring him here. David came in, and whenever he came into the presence of Samuel, God's Spirit said, that's the one. Samuel anointed David king. And here's what God's Spirit told Samuel. The Holy Spirit records this in 1 Samuel. God spoke to Samuel and said, man looks at the outside, but God looks at the heart. And we get that mixed up sometimes. We have a funny way of figuring out who God favors and who He doesn't. Who God's hand is upon and who it's not. Who's a worse sinner than you. We think we can figure all of that out just by looking at the outside. Here's two wives, Leah and Rachel. Rachel was the favorite. Now, to be fair to Jacob, can't you kind of understand why Rachel was the favorite? Because that's really the one he wanted to marry the whole time anyway, and he was tricked into marrying the other sister. Leah was put in a bad spot, wasn't she? Bad spot by her uncle, bad spot with Jacob. Verse 31 says, when the Lord saw that Leah was hated. Not just favored here, but hated. Hated by who? I guess Rachel. They certainly seem to be bitter and at odds with one another. Hated by Jacob, we don't know. But probably. I mean, it cost him 7 years of his life to marry a woman he didn't want to marry. It may very well have been Jacob that's included in this as well. The contrast seems to be between him and Leah and Rachel, but there's no doubt that Jacob could have been the one that hated her as well. He worked for 7 years of his life to marry a woman he didn't want to marry in the first place. But I'm going to tell you something. There may be people in this world that everybody around them hates them. God does not. He didn't hate Leah, for that matter, Rachel, or Jacob. You remember, Jacob was not the favored son himself. That was supposed to be Esau, but God chose to use Jacob instead. And now here's Leah. She's hated by her sister, possibly hated by her husband, but not hated by God. The Bible says that God opened her womb, and Rachel was barren. So here's the favored wife, Rachel, unable to have children. Leah was able to have children. That was a big deal in that day and time. Very big deal to be able to have children. I mean, for one thing, it meant security. Women weren't allowed to work. And so if your husband died, if he couldn't provide for you, if something happened to him and he couldn't provide for you, the only other option was you had sons and they could provide for you. That was the only option given to women. Now, if your son didn't have sons, here were your two options as a woman in that day. Two options. You could turn to prostitution or you could beg. That was your two options. And so that was a means of security for women to have a large family, a bunch of kids, especially young boys, have sons. And so women wanted to have children. It was also a respectable thing. You know, people considered women who didn't have children to be cursed by God. They thought that they were under the judgment of God for some reason. And so there's a social stigma to these women to not have kids. I'm going to tell you something. The world has changed a lot. People are a lot different now than they used to be. I think this is what Paul talks to Timothy about. He tells Timothy that in the last days, the love of many shall grow cold. I think that's what we're looking at. But I'm telling you, even in today's society where people's morals and views have changed, I'm going to tell you something. Having kids still means an awful lot to an awful lot of women. All right. I need y'all to pay attention for just a half a second. The older I've gotten, I'm not old, but I'm older than I was. And the older I have gotten, and the more I have seen the world change for the worse, the more I am convinced that women should find a lot of their satisfaction from being a wife and a mother and making that a priority in their life. Hey, some of you young folks, listen. Get married, have a bunch of kids, stay together, have a good family, and change your family, change this society, and change the world just by doing what God says. Have a good family and a big family and enjoy it. And let that be something meaningful to you. We live in a world that does not value motherhood at all. And a lot of women now today reject that and try to find meaning from something else, and you won't. All right, that's sermon number one. We're going to move on. That's soapbox for number one. We'll move on. Rachel is able to have children, Leah is able to have children. Rachel is not. And so you go down into chapter 20, chapter 29, you read the rest of these verses. It tells about the children that Leah has. You get into verse 1 of chapter 30. When Rachel saw that she bare Jacob no children, Rachel envied her sister and said unto Jacob, "Give me children or else I die." And Jacob's anger was kindled against Rachel. So here's the wife that he really loves and the wife he favors, but even the wife that you love can make you mad sometimes as a husband, I guess. And she says, "Give me children or I'm going to die." And he said, "What am I, God, to open a woman's... I can't do that. What do you mean?" He says this, "Am I in God's stead who hath withheld from thee the fruit of the womb? Am I God? What do you want me to do?" That's, by the way, the Scott Lingenfelter paraphrase of that verse. What do you want me to do, my God? Verse 3, she said, "Behold my maid Bilhah, going unto her, and she shall bear upon my knees, that I may also have children to her." Now, there are some of these cultural things that sound foreign to us, like marrying a relative. That was common in that day. That, you know, you marry a cousin, that sounds kind of icky to us. There's no mandate against that in Scripture anywhere. The Bible does have a mandate against marrying an immediate family member, you know, a brother or a sister or something like that. But when you get out into more extended family, the Bible doesn't have any prohibition against that. That's just more of a cultural thing for us. It kind of sounds icky to us to marry a cousin, except for Jerry Lee Lewis, I guess. Other than that, it sounds icky to us to do something like that. But there's no biblical prohibition against it, nothing immoral against that, just sort of a societal expectation now. But that sounds a little odd to our ears, to marry a relative like that. Nothing against it in the Bible. It also sounds a little odd for a man to marry two sisters. Well, I'll be honest with you, that part really isn't God's ideal. There isn't a mandate in the Bible about marrying a relative, cousin maybe. But when God made man, He made how many? Adam and Eve. And you don't see people start marrying men that marry multiple wives until you get deep into sin in Genesis, the later chapters of Genesis, chapters 7, 8, 9. You see men. Matter of fact, some of the most sinful people in the early chapters of Genesis, those were the ones who married multiple wives. So the sinners in the Bible were the ones who started marrying a bunch of women. That was never God's intention. By the New Testament, you see, even in that day, people had moved away from that. They only married one woman, even in the New Testament, for the most part. He marries his two sisters. That sounds a little icky to us, and it really should be. And you also see this principle where if you can't have children, if a woman couldn't have children, her servant could have children in her place, sort of a surrogate. Now, we have some things like that in our society even still, where women serve as surrogates for another woman maybe who can't have children. That still goes on even today. It may sound a little weird to some of you, sound a little icky, but I'm telling you, if it sounds a little weird, maybe it is a little weird, but there's a very good reason that many of the servant women were more than happy to have a son or a daughter who would be an heir to the person that they were serving. You talk about a way to move up in society, you have just guaranteed that your descendants will be far better off than you and the people who went before you would be. Most of the women in that day and age were more than happy for that to be a part of that arrangement because it automatically meant they would have kids and their kids would get to be a lot wealthier than they were. They wouldn't have to be a servant. They would be respected. They would have money. And so these servants often thought that was a way to step up for them and their family. And frankly, in a lot of cases, it was. Joseph goes in with Rachel's servant, has children by her. And you read through it, verse 6, and Rachel said, "God hath judged me and hath also heard my voice. Give me a son." So you go through all these different sons and daughters. Rachel, Leah in chapter 29 has several children, four. You get into chapter 30, Rachel starts having children through her servant. And finally, you get down to the end of this chapter, and Rachel herself has a child. And Rachel finally conceives and has a child. And God remembers her. Verse 22, God remembered Rachel and God hearkened to her and opened her womb and she conceived and bare a son and said, "God hath taken away my reproach," and she called his name Joseph. and said, the Lord shall add to me another son. So you see a little glimpse now. A little glimpse now. Y'all remember Joseph? Hey, can anybody tell me anything about Joseph? Let's narrow that down, that question down just a little bit. You know, we live in East Tennessee. Dollywood's right up the road. Dolly had a hit song about something based out of the life of Joseph here. Y'all remember a particular item of clothing that Joseph had? Coat of many colors. Dolly had a hit song about it. Now, Dolly had a coat of many colors because her parents didn't have enough money to afford a coat. And so her mom just kept strips of cloth and made her a coat. That's the story of Dolly. It's kind of the opposite of the story of Joseph. In Joseph's day, a coat of many colors didn't indicate that you didn't have much money. A coat of many colors indicated you have a lot of money. It was a very extravagant gift. Remember, colors had to come from other parts of the world. You couldn't get out your Crayola markers and just mark up whatever color you wanted. That was not the way that worked. Dyes came from things like plants from other parts of the world and from shells in the middle of the ocean somewhere. And these were people who lived in a fairly arid region. They didn't have a lot of the plants that you would need to make dyes. They didn't have seashells that you would need to crush or any of those sorts of things. Most of the dyes that they would have used had to come from far off. And it took a lot of manpower to get those things and a lot of travel to get them to where they were. Color was expensive. And so you get to the New Testament times and you see that purple is a symbol of royalty. Color purple was hard to get in those days. It was expensive. Only royalty could afford it. Well, a coat of many colors was an extravagant, expensive gift. Who got it? Joseph. Joseph was favored over all the other sons. And we'll get to that story later on as we go to that part of the Bible. But do you see now why Joseph was favored over all the other sons? Because Rachel was favored over Leah. And all of the children born to Jacob, the only one so far that has been born by Rachel herself, is Joseph. Now you all can tell me a little bit more about Joseph, can't you? Coat of many colors, the favorite son, but you also know he's the one sold into slavery in Egypt. And you know why he was sold into slavery in Egypt, don't you? His brothers hated him because his dad favored him. Folks, there are some fascinating stories on the sinfulness of man and the sovereignty of God all throughout Genesis. So, here's the one lesson we learned. Lesson number one is this. Don't show favoritism to one kid over another. I guess you only got one wife. I guess you can learn that lesson. Don't show favoritism to one wife over your other wife, but that's for the Mormons. We don't do that sort of thing. I thought that was a funny joke. Nobody liked the Mormon joke? Yeah, I didn't realize y'all were so sensitive about Mormons. All right. Don't show favoritism to one kid over another. You know what's going to happen if you show favoritism to one kid over another? All the other kids are going to resent that kid. He's going to wind up paying the price for you favoring that son or that daughter. Don't show favoritism to one kid over another. As a matter of fact, try not to do that in life. James talks about showing favoritism in church to rich people over poor people. And you let the rich guy in, he gets a seat right up front. You tell the poor person, sit in the back. The Bible is against favoritism in just about every setting. Treat everybody equally. Or at least try to. Best you can in life, treat people the same. Now, I need to caution you. Leah was hated, and so God favored her. But Joseph was favored, and God favored him. Just because a person is hated in society doesn't automatically obligate God to favor them above other people. And just because a person is favored in life doesn't mean that God is going to put them in their place and put them down. that certainly happened sometimes in the life of Joseph. But in the end, Joseph was the second in command of all of Egypt. He was the favored son, but still wound up being the second in command over all of Egypt. God did that. God did that. So God takes all these sinful situations, these sinful people, and God accomplishes His will. I don't know how that works. I wish I did. I don't know how God can work in the lives of sinful people, not just one sinful person, but sinful people, sinful nations, sinful countries, sinful rulers, and all throughout time and history and space. And God works all those things out together to His counsel, to His will, to His purposes. How does that work? I don't know. But I'm not God. I don't have to know. All I have to know is that I'm supposed to love Jesus Christ and serve Him faithfully. And I'll leave the rest up to Him. Two wives, 12 sons, but one Savior. That's where we're going. We're looking at the life of Jacob. We're looking at the life of Joseph. But ultimately, we're looking to the life of Jesus. Jacob, who was a scoundrel and didn't deserve grace, and he got it anyway. Joseph, who started this life with a silver spoon in his mouth, who wound up being sold into slavery, who gets in charge of Potiphar's house and then gets thrown back into jail, works his way up to the second command of all of Egypt, and ultimately brings his family down to Egypt to save them from starvation, and then they become slaves. Only God knows how all that works. Do you trust God with your life? I mean, really? In cases like this, who are you going to marry? How many kids are you going to have? What job are you going to work? Where are you going to live the rest of your life? Where are you going to go to church? How are you going to serve Him? What your spiritual gifts are? What you want to do for a living, what you want to do to serve the Lord. Are you going to trust the Lord with your health, with your finances? Are you going to trust the Lord with your salvation and your eternity? Are you going to trust that God can work all things out? That starts with Jesus, doesn't it? That's the first step to trusting God, is to trusting Jesus as the Lord and Savior of your life. Jesus left the splendor and the glory of heaven where He was worshipped, served, and adored, and He came to this earth. He was born a virgin birth. He lived a sinless life, and then He died on the cross. When He died on the cross, He died in your place and in my place for your sins and for my sins. He rose on the third day. He is victorious over sin, death, hell, and the grave. He has ascended to the right hand of the Father, and one day He's coming back to receive all those unto Himself who believe in Him. That is eternal life. That's the story of Jesus. Do you know Him? Do you love Him? Will you live for Him? Maybe you're here tonight and you have never asked Jesus to save you. Maybe you're watching this online and you've never made that decision. You can do that right here, right now, tonight. I'm going to pray a prayer. You pray this prayer with me. I'll pray it out loud and you pray it silently. If God is speaking to your heart and there's a decision you need to make, you pray this prayer with me. It goes like this. Jesus, I know I have sinned. I believe You died for my sins. I want You to forgive me for my sins. I want You to save me. I believe You died for my sins, and I believe You rose from the dead. I want You to be the Lord of my life. Thank You, Jesus, for saving me. Now help me to live for You. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, will you let me know that tonight? If you're here tonight, come talk with me. Come, I'll pray with you and talk with you about that decision. That's not the end. That's just the beginning, getting saved. Maybe there's some other decision you need to make here tonight. You want to join our church? You want to be baptized? You've been saved and you want to follow the Lord in baptism? Maybe you want to join our church? Maybe you're a Christian, but there's some sin in your life and you need to repent of that and rededicate your life to Jesus. Maybe you just need to be at this altar praying and leaving a burden here with the Lord. whatever decision you need to make, if God's calling you, step out and come. Would you stand with me? Heads bowed and eyes closed. Christians praying. If God is speaking to you.